I think I said last time that in future I wanted to add music to my lectures. Unfortunately, the time has not been sufficient, but I'm totally convinced that the way to go in the future is to add music as a constant soundtrack to my lectures. And then eventually I shall add dance and all kinds of things, because I'm fed up with lecturing, you know, it's so boring. So at least I have pictures. But also the trouble is I spend a lot of time preparing for these lectures, but then I always have the best ideas at the very last moment. That's why I asked for the whiteboard, because as I walked in, I suddenly realized what I should be talking about, which is quite different from what I've prepared. So if you will forgive me, I'm going to begin by talking about a very important philosophical issue, which is to do with the ownership of literature, about which I have very strong views. And in connection with that, I've written up some words here. The first is lineage, the second is legacy, the third is literary executor, and the fourth is intellectual property. Now, and then I've written here three names, Arthur Whaley, David Hawkes, and myself, because towards the end of this lecture, I'm going to be exploring an extremely controversial topic, which is what happened to Arthur Whaley's papers. Because for me, it's an absolute scandal, and this is, I've known about it for some years, but this is the first time I've spoken about it in public. So I'm going to preserve that for the last half an hour of my talk. And it's actually quite a bombshell, I have to say. But before I get to that, I want to talk about lineage, because one of the, excuse me, I think I better sit down. One of the recurring themes or motifs in this series of talks, I mean, my four lectures are like a huge four-movement symphony by Gustav Mahler, you see, and I'm now in the third movement, and it's getting more and more, it's building up. The motif is becoming more and more pronounced, because the motif is about how translators represent a certain tradition. They represent a certain way of thinking, a certain way of creating, and for that they depend upon their education, or their formation in the French sense, their xiuyang in the Chinese sense. And you see, these people, just like the great masters of any school of thought, they pass things down from one generation to the next, and that becomes a very important part of their task. And in the case of translators, it's doubly true. And I've talked already about James Legge and Herbert Giles. We had a lot of fun last week with Herbert Giles. But you see, he was actually a very serious person. And all of these four translators I'm talking about belonged in a lineage. And of course, lineage is a word used a lot in, for example, Buddhism, where you have the first patriarch and the second patriarch, and you know, and you hand over the bowl to the next one, or you hit him on the head and you say, "You are my disciple." And lineage is a very strange thing. It's very, very powerful. And of course, it's connected with the very important Chinese concept of yuanfen, you know, of affinity, of predestination, and of that magical word that we talked about in one of my workshops, that word tong, you know, which means connection. And through all of these people, through Legge, Giles, Whaley, and Hawkes, there is a link. There's a lineage. They receive the tradition from the previous person. Now, very often that lineage is actually made concrete in the form of a legacy. Now, a legacy can be a metaphorical thing. It can also be a very physical thing when somebody writes their last will and testament and they leave things to somebody else. That's called a legacy as well. And in the case of literature, it takes on a very special form whereby somebody at the end of their life, or towards the end of their life, not that anybody ever knows what the end of their life is going to be, but they have to decide what to do with their literary property, which is a horrible word because there is no such thing as literary property. But on the other hand, writers and translators, they produce books, and those books have a physical existence, and they earn money, and so on and so forth. So at some point, a writer or a translator has to decide to whom they are going to bequeath their literary property. Now, this happened with Arthur Whaley, and towards the end of his life, he decided to bequeath his intellectual property, which means all of his writings unpublished, all of his letters, all of his papers, he bequeathed them to his literary executor. It's a very important legal term. And his literary executor was David Hawkes. And David Hawkes, towards the end of his life, had to make a very similar decision, and he bequeathed all of his intellectual property to me. So you see, I stand here today as the last in a line of a very special lineage. That's why I feel very strongly about this issue, and I shall come back to that at the end of this talk. I don't want to spend the whole talk going on about that, because that's not the point, but I'm warning you now that I'm going to come back to that at the end and give you some very shocking information. I mean, really scandalous information. And this is the first time this has ever been made public. All right, that's by way of a warning. And the next warning is that I will, next time I come back to this lovely college, I will be giving lectures with accompanying music. And I will have a musical advisor who will help me on this, because I think that it's very important to have music. I mean, what film can work without music, you know? So why don't we have music in lectures as well? And sometimes the music could be improvised on stage, you know, with a string quartet or a pianist or even, I went to a wonderful film on Tuesday, I think it was, or Monday, about my friend, the poet, Liang Pingquan, you know, Ye Si. And in the middle of that film, there was the most powerful sequence, 10 minutes, in which some of his early poems about lotus leaves, which I translated actually back in 1984, they were performed by a dancer, a very wonderful dancer who was a friend of the poet. And she performed them in the most beautiful way as the poems were read aloud. And the translation was actually shown on the screen. So I felt very moved. And also at the same time, this violinist, Kung Chi Sing, who was also a friend of Liang Pingguan's, played the violin. And what a superb moment it was, because it was a combination of dance, music, and poetry. And it was one of the finest Hong Kong artistic events I have ever witnessed. It was very, very powerful. It could only have happened in Hong Kong, and it was very wonderful. So I think that we teachers should not stand aside from this trend. We should move towards, you know, the fusion of all possible media in the future means of delivering our message. Well, today I'm going to talk about really a very, very remarkable man. I mean, a unique figure. He transcends all boundaries. He is perhaps the greatest ever translator of Chinese literature. I cannot imagine anybody ever being better than Arthur Whaley. And his story, as you know, one of my other themes in this section, in this series of lectures, is to do with translators being individuals who have lives and who have physical and emotional beings. And in the case of Arthur Whaley, his story is very, very interesting. I mean, he belonged to the next generation after Herbert Giles. You see, Herbert Giles lived in the late Victorian and Edwardian period. Arthur Whaley was born in 1889, and he died in 1966 on June the 27th, 5 days after my birthday. And so he lived into the modern age, and he was very much part of the whole post-war, post-First World War, modernist movement in London. He knew everybody. And one of the great paradoxes about Arthur Whaley, who I never met, incidentally, was that he was a very silent and somewhat eccentric and somewhat forbidding individual, and yet he had an enormous number of friends who all loved him very dearly, and he had creative relationships with artists, musicians, poets, and of course translators. And he used his ability with the Chinese language to create a huge body of work, some 30 or 40 books, and all of it of a very, very high quality. Sometimes students come to me and say, what should I do to improve my skills as a user of two languages? And I say to them sometimes, read The Story of the Stone, read Hong Lo Meng, not my bit, but read David Hawkes' bit, because both the Chinese and the English are absolutely superb. You can't go wrong. But you see, I also say to them, read everything that Arthur Whaley ever wrote, because he was a supreme stylist, and he was a scholar, And he had that quality. You remember I mentioned in my first lecture Leonardo da Vinci's definition of genius. I'm not going to ask you to repeat it, but his definition of genius was eternal patience. Eternal patience. And what Leonardo was trying to say was, there is no such thing as genius. There is of course genius, so we know that, but he was trying to be modest, and he was saying, I just have to be eternally patient, and I have to work hard. And in the case of translators, we have to revise and revise and revise. Well, you see, Whaley had the most extraordinary patience. He was a very, very meticulous scholar, but he was also a very, very creative thinker and artist. And there's been nobody like him, and there will never be anybody like him again, because he was such an unusual mixture of things. I'll give you one example. Arthur Whaley possessed a complete edition of the 24 histories, you know, the traditional Chinese dynastic histories, beginning with Sima Qian's, you know, Shiji, and going right up until the Ming. And he had a complete set of this, what they call the Bona Ben of the Ursha Susha, the 24 histories. And he gave it, shortly before he died, he gave it to David Hawkes, who was his favorite student and friend. And David possessed that. And it's the most remarkable book because it contains Arthur Whaley's handwritten notes. And he read the whole thing, you know. I mean, this is not a man who just dipped into things. He's not like me, you know. I'm very, very superficial. I mean, Arthur Whaley was an extraordinary combination of a very deep and hard-working scholar and someone who was transcendently creative. And you just won't find that more than once in a few hundred years, you know, if that. So that's an example. Now, I'm going to tell his story because I do, as you know, I believe in telling stories more than anything else. And I think that's a very fine lineage. It goes all the way back to Zhuangzi, you know. And of course, all my favorite writers tell stories. You know, Zhuangzi, Pu Songling, Cao Xueqin, they all tell stories. And he was born, anyway, Arthur Whaley was born. There we go. Can we have the lights down a little bit, please? I won't fall off the edge, I promise. This is Arthur Whaley as a little boy, you see. Now, he was born into a family called Schloss, which, of course, in German means castle. And it was a very wealthy Jewish family in London. And he kept that name until about 19, or his family kept that name until about 1910, when things were getting a bit difficult with Germany. So, and then they took his mother's name, which was Whaley, which is also a Jewish family. The problem in those days wasn't being Jewish. The problem was having a German name. And you can see his rather lovely sort of late 19th century costume. He looks a bit like little Lord Fauntleroy. As a small boy, he did what every upper-class small boy in England does. He went to a boarding school at the age of about 10. What a terrible thing. No, in fact, he was even younger than that. I was sent off to boarding school when I was 8. That was supposed to be the way to make men out of boys, you see. And then later you sent them off to the British Empire to rule the world. And, you know, my mother used to call me up from Egypt and say, how are you getting on, Johnny? And I'd say, I'm fine. And I'd go back and cry for about 3 hours, you know. And we all lived in dormitories, and it was really an extraordinary part of the British system. It still exists, you know. But this was his prep school. It was a very expensive and elite prep school, which especially prepared boys for the school known as rugby school. Now, you've heard of rugby as a game played with an olive-shaped ball, you know. But actually, it was just a kind of football played at a school. At my school, which was called Winchester, we had Winchester football, and at Eton, they had Eton, the Eton game, which was every British public school had its own version of football. It's just that rugby caught on and became an international sport. So rugby was a very famous school, famous for its tradition, and this is the important part, famous for its tradition in classical studies. Now, you've heard me say that about James Legge, you've heard me say that about Herbert Giles. I'm afraid it's the same about Arthur Whaley. He learned Latin and Greek, and he became very, very good at Latin and Greek, starting at his prep school, his preparatory school, and then going on when he went to rugby. There's rugby, you see, founded in 1567 in the last years of the Ming Dynasty. Not that they even knew about the Ming Dynasty in those days, but it was a very famous, one of the top 10 British public schools. And Arthur Whaley went to school, he went to school at Rugby, and he did very, very well. He won the prize for classics, and he got a scholarship to go to Cambridge. So you see, it's very interesting because of the four people I'm talking about, Legge, Giles, Whaley and Hawkes, two of them went to Cambridge and two of them went to Oxford. So it's a very fair distribution, you know. I went to Oxford, but then I don't count, you see. Now, this was the famous headmaster of Rugby School called Thomas Arnold, who was a very great reforming headmaster who wanted to base the curriculum at Rugby on what he called the complete man, you know. Every generation has people like that. They think they can change the education system and encourage people to be complete men, you know, or sometimes women. And he was one of them. And of course, he was very, very influential. And he had a very famous son who was even more influential called Matthew Arnold. Matthew Arnold happens to be one of my favorite poets because he wrote a poem called The Scholar Gypsy, which is all about an Oxford student who leaves the university to go and live with the gypsies, which is exactly what I did. And so I always liked, but I don't like his sideburns at all. I think he needs to go to the barber and have a good shave, you know. But that was the trend in those days, you know. And I like this quote of his, "Culture is to know the best that has been said and thought in the world." Well, I would expand that to say created, because how do you have to just think about, how do you only include saying and thinking things? What about music? I'm sorry, I'm going on about music today, but you know, I think translation and music are so closely connected, it's ridiculous. Anyway, don't let me go off on another digression. I think I should have somebody with a red card every time I go on a digression. You know? Leo, do you want to be the prefect in charge of my digressions? But you say you like digressions, right? Okay. Okay. All right. Anyway, Arthur Whaley, although he became a very refined man of letters, was also he loved sport, you know. And when he was a boy, he played cricket, as every true Englishman should do. I played cricket rather badly. And there he is. I mean, I think he once said to someone he just liked to play cricket to dress up in white clothes because they're rather nice. And there he is wearing his cricket gear. Probably at Rugby, I think. I think he looks like he's probably about 12 or 13. And then he grew up to be rather a good-looking young man, rather what I think my children's, well, no, not my children's generation, my generation, perhaps when I was younger, would call dishy, you know. I mean, you can see he's rather a beautiful young man. And this becomes an important part of his life story later on. Sorry, I'm not writing a sort of cheap romance, by the way, in case you're hoping. It ends rather boringly. He was a very good-looking young man. So was David Hawkes, by the way. We'll come to that next week. I'll keep you in suspense. I've got some great photos of David Hawkes as a young man. But this is Arthur Whaley. And sorry, I've gone too fast. So at the age of about 17 or 18, he went to Cambridge. And of course, he went to the best college at Cambridge, which is King's College, Cambridge, founded by King Henry VI in 1441. You see, that's the very early years of the Ming Dynasty. And there they are punting, you see. And Cambridge is a very beautiful place. And King's College is traditionally supposed to be the number one college, you know. And in Oxford, they usually say that about Christ Church College, which was also founded by a king, King Henry VIII, rather a different king from Henry VI. Anyway, I digress. So he went to King's College, and this is where his life really enters its interesting phase. Because in those days, Cambridge was the most extraordinary place. It was full of interesting people. And Arthur Whaley just plunged into the whole Cambridge scene and became close friends with a lot of very important people from a very early age. I hope I've got my slides in the right order. Oh yes, goodness me, I have. Now this gentleman here, Goldsworthy Lois Dickinson, he wrote a very famous book called Letters of John Chinaman, which I recommend to you. It's beautifully written. And he was actually Arthur Whaley's tutor at King's College. Now, a tutor in the old system in Oxford and Cambridge was a very special person. They didn't necessarily teach your subject, but but they looked after you. They were your sort of pastoral minder, you know, and they were the people you went to see your tutor, and they would look after your life. Actually, in my day, they didn't do anything of the sort, but, I mean, Goldsworthy Dickinson was Arthur Whaley's tutor, and you see, it was Goldsworthy Lois Dickinson who introduced Arthur Whaley to China. That was the first that Arthur Whaley ever really knew about China, was from Goldsworthy Lois Dickinson. And Lois Dickinson wrote this book called Letters from John Chinaman, which is a wonderful piece of prose, which has got virtually nothing to do with China at all. And when somebody asked him, how do you know all that? Have you been to China? Do you know Chinese? He said, no. I've never been to China. I don't know a word of Chinese. But you see, I was Chinese in a former life. So, you know, if you can say that, you can get away with anything. And anyway, his essays about life and art were cast in the form of letters from a Chinese person who comes to Europe. It was an old tradition going back to the 18th century and Goldsmith, but Dickinson fired Whaley with enthusiasm that was to bear fruit much later. But Whaley wasn't studying Chinese at Cambridge. He was studying, and here again, one of my leitmotifs, you see, I can hear the cellos coming in, you know, he studied Latin and Greek, as did Legge, as did Giles, as did David Hawkes, as did I. So, I mean, you know, we're all part of the same gang, and Whaley studied Latin and Greek, and he took his exam, and he got a first-class honours result in his first half of his exam. And then he went, I hope my slides are in the right order. He also met a man called John Maynard Keynes, who became a very famous economist. And all these young men at Cambridge were part of a group called the Apostles, which you might have heard of. The Apostles was like a secret society, you know. You can never really find out who were members because they were sworn to secrecy. And the leader of the Apostles was this gentleman here called G.E. Moore, who was really a philosopher. But he brought together a group of young men at Cambridge who had very high ideals, and they used to meet and talk about things. It was like a salon, but they were very serious young men. And later on, they were joined by, for example, Ludwig Wittgenstein, who was perhaps the greatest English language philosopher of the 20th century. And they were not only very brilliant, they were also very into art, and they were very aesthetic. And many of them were actually what they would call today gay, right? I mean, there was a lot of homoerotic kind of discussions going on in this circle in Cambridge. And there's a lot of questions asked about Arthur Whaley's own sexual orientation. I'm not interested in that. I have no idea. He can do whatever he likes, as far as I'm concerned. I have no evidence that he was actually a closet homosexual, although some people like to argue that. I mean, if you're in the closet, how can anyone ever know, you know, except by breaking down the door, and then they'll just find you dead, probably. So anyway, these were all his friends at Cambridge. And here he is as a young man wearing a rather nice bow tie, as you can see. I approve of his choice of bow tie. And you see, he dresses well, and he's got that rather nice languid look about him, you know. I mean, he's sort of grown up from being a cricket-playing boy at public school to being obviously a rather well-dressed and rather sensitive young man mixing with the Apostles. Now, the Apostles survived well into the 30s and 40s, and they had all sorts of members, some of whom became Soviet Union spies, like, for example, the famous Guy Burgess, you know, Burgess and Maclean. And Burgess actually went to the same prep school as Arthur Whaley. So there's some interesting connections here. Anyway, after his first 3 years at Cambridge, Whaley, and I think this is an important fact, he decided to just go off and do a walking tour of Spain. In fact, he went around the whole of Europe. He spent a whole year. He just walked in what 50 years later we would say he dropped out. He had a very serious problem with one of his eyes. He actually lost the sight of one eye. Something very few people know is that throughout his entire creative life, Whaley only had one working eye. It gives hope to those of us who are having trouble with our eyes. But he had one eye, and yet he wrote about 40 books, you know, and he was a manic reader. And he went off on a walking tour of Spain, and before that he lived in France and Germany for a year, becoming very fluent in both French and German, so that he wanted to be able to read their literatures. So he just went and wandered around France and Germany. And unfortunately, we don't really know what he did. One day perhaps we might. And then he went off on a walking tour of Spain. He couldn't decide what to do. Should he go back to Cambridge, or should he just give up university and just go into business? And his family, you know, being very successful Jewish family, had lots of connections in the business world. And while he was on this tour of Spain, a family friend actually came up with an idea that he should go and join a family company selling pianos in South America. So, you know, he could have ended up as a piano dealer in Buenos Aires, but he decided not to. And then he got a message, he got a telegram from a friend saying, you might have a chance of getting a job at the British Museum, because they need someone to help in the Department of Asian Art, Japanese and Chinese paintings. Well, of course, he knew nothing about Chinese or Japanese art, but he thought he might as well have a go. And this is the British Museum, one of the great museums of the world. And that's a sort of aerial view. It's not a very good one. And anyway, Arthur Whaley went in for the exam, and he sat an exam which his father said, you don't stand a chance, you know, it's much too difficult. But he was immediately passed, and he was appointed to the Department of Asian Art under a very interesting man. And I think another theme that comes out in these stories is people, they meet people, and those encounters can become very, very important. I think the Chinese call it yuanfen, you know. I mean, I'm never sure how to translate yuanfen. I've no idea. I just call it yuanfen, because which some people think is a kind of noodles, you know. Actually, no, it is a kind of life noodles, you know, because it sort of connects you, the thread of yuanfen. And you encounter people, and they become part of your life, you know. But they don't if you don't take the opportunity. I've talked about this before, about how some people, they really take opportunities, and they need to do that. If something happens, you have to have a sense. It's almost like a sixth sense that this is an important thing. You should go for it, you know. And don't worry if it doesn't happen, but you should at least go for it. So he went for this job at the British Museum. And that was the beginning of the next phase of his life, when he basically settled down in an area of London known as Bloomsbury. And that's a very important word. I'm going to write it up here. It's the key word of today's talk, really. It's actually the name of that area of London around the British Museum. And this is one of the squares near, near the British Museum called Bedford Square. Oh dear, that seems to have got off. Anyway, that says people who were sent copies of Whaley's first small hand-bound and privately printed book of Chinese poems in translation in 1916. You see, I wanted to draw a picture of his circle of friends, and one of the ways of doing that was I managed to get the names of all the people that he sent copies of his very first book. And his very first book was a hand-printed Christmas present with about 40 translations that he did in his spare time at the British Museum. He taught himself Chinese, basically from reading the calligraphy on paintings. He's completely self-taught, and he just had fun translating poems. That's what he wanted to do for fun. And he put them together, he hand-bound them, and hand covered them and sent them off to people. And we have a record of who he sent them to. And I think that by looking at these people, you know, in 1916, and he was still a very young man, he was only 27, just starting off his career as a translator, this was his very first publication, we get some idea of the kind of people he was mixing with. And it's a very remarkable list, you'll see in a minute. Now, one of the very important people was an artist called Roger Fry. And this is a self-portrait by Roger Fry. Roger Fry was a core member of what later came to be called the Bloomsbury Group. The Bloomsbury Group was a very important sort of group of artists and writers and thinkers that came together basically in this time just before 1920 and lasted right through into the 1930s. And this is one of Roger Fry's paintings. Now, the Bloomsbury people were famous for being creative, but also for being very unconventional. Unconventional in their lifestyle, unconventional in their sexual habits. They often lived in triangular relationships where there might be two men and a woman, and you didn't really know whether the man was in love with the man and the woman or what. And as I went to visit one of their country houses in 2009 with David Hawkes, and David Hawkes was a great admirer of the Bloomsbury set, you see. But we went to their country house in Sussex called Charleston, and I walked around the house with David, and he just said to me, what a nightmare it must have been to live in this house, because you never knew who you were going to wake up in bed with in the morning, you know. And it was very confusing, because not only did you not know who you would wake up in bed with, but you didn't know what gender the person would be. It was very, very interesting times, you know. And we'll encounter some more of these people. This was one of the people that Arthur Whaley sent a copy to. It was a very famous book illustrator called Edmund Dulac. This is one of his less shocking pictures. Most of them have naked ladies on them. This one is only half naked, and it's called Silence. And he was one of Whaley's friends, you see. And this was Dulac's caricature of Whaley. You know, this is his picture of Whaley, you see, reading Japanese and looking totally mad. And this is Dulac, you see, Edmund Dulac. This was a friend of Whaley's called R.C. Trevelyan, who was a poet. And later on, I shall read you a poem that he wrote about Arthur Whaley. And this is Logan Pearsall Smith, who was a very punctilious person about language. He wrote books about how to write, about the craft of writing, very, very detailed, precise. He was very, very famous for being a terrifically precise user of the English language, and so was Whaley, you see. The Bloomsbury set, they were such good writers, you know. And of course, Yeats was not a member of the Bloomsbury set, but he was one of Whaley's friends. And Whaley sent him a copy as well of his first little tiny book of Chinese poems. Yeats was already at that time quite, he was already like 50 or 45, but he was a famous figure at this point, a senior figure. This young lady, who's got a very beautiful face, she was not very well known, but she was a painter. And I did a little bit of research about her. She was a sort of younger member of the set who painted rather sort of impressionistic paintings. He sent her a copy as well. Now here's Clive Bell. Clive Bell was a very important member who wrote of the set, who was a painter. He also wrote books on aesthetics, on the history of art. And he famously had a love affair with Virginia Woolf. Well, Virginia Woolf was happy to have love affairs with anybody, and she was quite bad news in some ways. But there she is. I mean, look at her. Gosh, you'd run a mile from somebody like that, would you? But Clive Bell is absolutely at her mercy. You can see he's about to do whatever she tells him to do. And Virginia Woolf and her sister Vanessa were more or less the high priestesses of the Bloomsbury set, and they were both close friends of Arthur Whaley's. And this man, Sidney Cockerell, he was a rather more sort of austere member of Whaley's circle. He was the curator of the museum in Cambridge called the Fitzwilliam. Now this man, of course, needs no introduction. Later on he became very, very famous, Bertrand Russell. He was also sent a copy of Whaley's little book, you see. It was sent out as a Christmas present. And Walter Sickert was the famous painter. And perhaps the most notorious of the whole Bloomsbury set was a lady called Dora Carrington. They made a movie about her with Emma Thompson, and it's all about her and her relationship to Lytton Strachey. Lytton Strachey was definitely gay, but Dora loved him, so she lived in a kind of triangular relationship, yet another of these Bloomsbury triangles, with Lytton Strachey and his boyfriend. And she was a very good painter. Another person who received a copy and who later had a book dedicated to him by Arthur Whaley was Harold Acton, also gay and also very interested in China, and spent quite some years in Peking, surrounded by young Chinese men. He obviously enjoyed their company, and he translated poetry as well. And he came from a very aristocratic family that owned a palace in Italy. and he was a member. This is the circle, you see, that Whaley belonged to. I mean, it's quite extraordinary. He knew everybody. And then, from then onwards, he became more and more part of the Bloomsbury set. This is where I need music, you see, because some music would just... And you see, here's an actual painting of Whaley by Roger Fry. I'd never seen it before. I found it on the internet. It's a rather interesting painting, isn't it? It captures his kind of rather melancholy, sort of withdrawn mode of being. And here's Whaley. See, there's Whaley at the bottom there. Oh, I can use this little red thing, can't I? Yes, there's Whaley looking rather depressed. And there's Lytton Strachey with the beard, you know. Lytton Strachey was one of the most famous members of the Bloomsbury set. And he was a very, very interesting man. He wrote a very famous book called Eminent Victorians, which was completely destroyed the myth of the Victorian age. The biographies of four famous Victorian figures, including General Gordon, who, of course, came out to China and saved China from the Taiping Rebellion. But he wrote about Florence Nightingale and so on. And he received a copy of Whaley's book. And here's Whaley with some more friends. Where's my red thing? Oh, there's Whaley. Oh, sorry, I've gone. Yeah, there's Whaley. I don't actually know who these people are, but they were other members of the Bloomsbury set. And here he is. There's Lytton Strachey again. He's got his hand covering his beard. And this is Dora Carrington, the painter, who was in love with Lytton, but Lytton was in love with him. And Whaley was just sitting and watching and smoking his pipe, you see, which is sort of characteristic of Whaley. There's some speculation as to whether he ever had any physical contact with anybody at all, but I frankly don't care. That's up to him, you know. And here he is. This is a painting by another of the most important literary figures of the time, Lady Ottiline Morell, who used to give a sort of garden parties all the time to the Bloomsbury set and to others. She was also very much a patron of D.H. Lawrence. And her husband, Morell, he owned the big brewery in Oxford. He made his money out of making beer. But Lady Ottiline spent all of his money on supporting artists and writers. And this is her photograph of Whaley. He's always slightly, you know, hanging his head like that. It's very interesting. I think every single photograph so far, he's in this position. Now, towards the end of this decade, in fact, I think in the year 1918, all of this is written down in your handout, but he met this extraordinary woman called Beryl de Zoet. I don't know how to pronounce her name. It's a Dutch name, I think. I just call her Beryl de Zoet. And this is a painting of her by a painter I've never heard of. She was quite a striking lady. And she was a vegetarian. And she lived with Arthur Whaley from 1918 until 1962. She was his constant companion throughout his life. She also went off and had love affairs with numerous other men. And Whaley was always waiting for her at home, you know. He was that kind of a guy. And she was a very, very talented and creative woman. And her great expertise was in Balinese dance. And she wrote the absolute classic study with somebody called Walter Spies. She wrote the book called Dance and Drama in Bali, which to this day is the classic study of Balinese dance. And she was a very, very strong individual with a very strong personality. And she and Whaley had a wonderful companionship for nearly 40 years. This is a photograph of her, not a very clear one, by the famous photographer Cecil Beaton. And this is Whaley with Beryl in Switzerland in the early 1920s. He was basically, you know, the love of his life. And he wrote many, many letters to her, but I'll talk about those at the end. And she was a great dancer. She was trained as a dancer, and she was into the style of dancing which today we associate with people like Martha Graham. And she wrote regular critiques of dance in the British press. and this was a Frederick Ashton ballet based on Dante's Divine Comedy, which she wrote a long essay about. So she was a very, very interesting and creative woman. Now, these are the two beauties of the Bloomsbury group, Vanessa and Virginia Woolf, but of course they were originally called Stevens, but Vanessa married a Bell and Virginia married Leonard Woolf, and so they became Vanessa Bell and Virginia Woolf. And they're very, very striking ladies, and they sort of dominated the whole Bloomsbury scene. I think that if you read the writings of Virginia Woolf, you see a wonderful counterpoint to Arthur Whaley's style of writing, because Virginia Woolf was a superb stylist. I mean, I used to be a huge reader of Virginia Woolf until I read her journals and her letters, and I thought she was such a depressing individual. I couldn't bear to read her anymore. She was very, you know, she was kind of suicidal most of her life, highly neurotic, and I found her letters her journals to be very self-obsessed, and I sort of got turned off her about 20 years ago. But recently I came back to reading some of her essays, and they're absolutely superb. So she was one of the dominant people in the whole Bloomsbury world. And that's a painting of her by Roger Fry, one of the great artists in the Bloomsbury. This is a kind of popular, you know, family tree of the Bloomsbury set, you know, and all their connections. And as you can see, often they're connected to several different people. I won't spend too much time on that. And they made a BBC TV series about 2 years ago, which I've never seen, called Life in Squares, meaning the squares in Bloomsbury, you know, Bedford Square, Gordon Square, and so on and so forth. And they all dressed up like the Bloomsburyites. Apparently it was quite interesting. Now, somebody who really wasn't part of Bloomsbury, but who was very, very important in Whaley's life, was this extraordinary lady called Edith Sitwell. Now, there were three of them. There was Edith Sitwell, Osbert Sitwell, and Sacheverell Sitwell. And they came from a very grand aristocratic family. You see, Whaley mixed with the higher levels of British society. He didn't waste his time with ordinary people like me. He used to go and stay often for the weekend in the Sitwell family mansion. And I think I've got a picture of it. That's a painting of Edith Sitwell by the same painter, by Roger Fry. And here she is with her two brothers. They were all very close friends of Arthur Whaley's. And that's where they lived, that little house of theirs in the countryside, with probably about 17 bedrooms and about 30 acres of parkland. They lived in a very beautiful country house. And that was where Arthur Whaley used to often go and spend weekends. And there's a very charming story about one particular weekend. Sorry, I'm just going to have a drink of water because my voice is slightly giving out. One weekend, Arthur Whaley went to stay with the Sitwells, and there were usually other famous people staying as well. It was a typical country house party, you know. Forget about Downton Abbey. I mean, these were real people. And Arthur Whaley came down to the breakfast table, which was a very large table full of silverware with all the most wonderful, a full English breakfast, you can be sure, several kinds of tea and so on. And he sat down at his place, and he saw that there was a little book there on his table mat. And he picked it up, and he looked at it. And Edith Sitwell had placed it there. And she was sitting at the other end of the table, and he said, "Well, Arthur, what is it?" And he looked at it and he said, "Turkish, 17th century." And then she said, "Well, what does it say?" And he just flicked it. He said, "Oh, it says, 'The cat sat on the mat.'" "Oh, is it a children's book?" "I think so. I would hope so." And that was Arthur Whaley. And it's one of those stories, you know, there's a wonderful Chinese book called Shi Shuo Xin Yu, you know, which has little stories like that about people. And it conjures up not just Arthur Whaley, but his whole world, you know, and the whole circle in which he lived. They just had little parlor games like that. Now, I did have a YouTube clip of Edith Sitwell reading a poem. And if I have time, I'd like to play it to you later. But I think we should move on because there's that clock. Thank you so much. Yes, it's nearly 3 o'clock. Okay. And there were other people in Arthur Whaley's circle. This was one of them, Lord Berners, Lord Farringdon. I knew where he lived, Farringdon House, because when I grew up, I was very close by. And he was a composer, a musical composer. He was always referred to as the British Eric Satie. And he wrote very lovely music of a sort of impressionist type. He also ran an establishment famous for its cultivation of gay young men. And he was a painter as well. And this was his lifelong companion, Robert Heber Percy. And when Lord Berners died, he actually left all of his estate to his long-term companion, Robert Heber Percy, whose painting he did. There's his name, you see. There's Berners' name there. He was a friend of Arthur Whaley's. So was T.S. Eliot. When T.S. Eliot came to London, one of the very first people he befriended and used to have regular lunches with every week was Arthur Whaley. They were very close friends. So was Ezra Pound. I mean, you know, Arthur Whaley knew everybody. He used to have regular lunches with T.S. Eliot and Ezra Pound. And he, of course, Ezra Pound always had difficult relationships with everybody. He used to praise them and attack them in the same breath, you know. So he'd say how wonderful Arthur Whaley was and then go on to say he just hadn't got a clue, you know. But you know, they were both discovering Chinese poetry at more or less the same time. Very interesting coexistence. And another person that was very important in Whaley's life was Ian Forster, one of the great leading lights of the Cambridge literary scene and a very key figure in Bloomsbury. And the young writer Ronald Furbank, famous now in gay literature, he was first discovered as a writer by Arthur Whaley, who wrote a preface to his first book. And this is his publisher, Sir Stanley Unwin. And Sir Stanley Unwin was a real gentleman publisher. He set up the firm of Allen and Unwin. And he published just about all of Whaley's books. And they would just meet, you know, occasionally and have conversations which would go something like, oh, hello, Arthur, how's it going? What would you like to translate? Oh, well, I'm thinking of translating a very, very long Japanese novel called The Tale of Genji. It's so long, it'll have to be 6 volumes. And then Sir Stanley would just say, oh, yes, jolly good show, do it then. Why don't you? And that was the way it worked, you know. It wasn't like today's publishers who have to go through their accountants and do complicated financial negotiations, you know. He was a real gentleman publisher, and he wrote a wonderful book about his life as a publisher. And he was Arthur Whaley's friend, you see, and patron. And he looked such a kind man, I think. And this was Arthur Whaley's boss at the British Museum, where he worked for about 20 years, Lawrence Binion, who was also a poet and a translator himself. So Whaley was very fortunate to have, this is also Lawrence Binion, the man he worked with. And here we have back to Whaley, you see. What an extraordinary face he had. He used to love going to Switzerland. He was a very keen skier. And this is a picture of him on one of his visits to Switzerland. And here you are, he's at a concert during the war. And he's sitting next to, that's Princess Elizabeth, who is now Queen Elizabeth II and 80-something years old. And that, I've forgotten who that is for a moment. But that's Osbert Sitwell, yes, that's one of the Sitwells. That is Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, who's now no longer alive. That was Princess Margaret, who's also, I think, no longer alive. And that was the poet Walter de la Mare. So, you know, Arthur Whaley mixed with royalty and with the absolute crème de la crème of English literary life. Here he is skiing in Austria. He was always a very, very keen skier. He's having a smoke in between ski runs. And here he is in Italy. He loved going to Italy. There he is with his pipe in his mouth again, and being served, no doubt, a glass of excellent Italian wine. I mean, he knew how to enjoy life in his own way. There he is skiing in Norway. And there he is attending a literary lunch, wearing rather a nice bow tie. Now, we come to the lady in the story. Her name is Alison, and she was called Alison Grant, and she's from New Zealand. And She first of all married a Mr. Robinson and later fell in love with Arthur Whaley and was kind of on the sidelines of his life for a very long time and very jealous of Beryl de Zoet. And I think she had the occasional little fling with him. Exactly how, we don't really know. But later on, when Beryl died in 1962, Alison homed in like a sort of vampire and got hold of Whaley. Sorry, I shall have to edit this video. And got hold of Whaley and dragged him off 1 month before he died to the registry office and married him. Whaley didn't believe in marriage at all. Nobody in the Bloomsbury set got married, really. I mean, one didn't do that kind of thing, you know. And anyway, but Alison really had a crush on Whaley. She wrote a book about it. Maybe I've got it next. No. This is Whaley late in life, reading in the open air. And those are all the volumes of his Tale of Genji, you know, the Yuan Shi Wu Yu. One of his absolute masterpieces. I mean, it's the most beautifully written English novel. All of his books were very beautifully produced. You know, look at the binding on this edition of his 170 points. Look at this title page of his translation of COG, designed by Duncan Grant, you see. Oh dear, what's happened? I'm pressing too many things at once, sorry. That's Duncan Grant. He was one of the artists. He was the bisexual artist of the, Bloomsbury set. And he designed this picture of Sun Wukong. It doesn't look much like Sun Wukong to me, but anyway, that was his creative take on Sun Wukong. And here's Duncan Grant. You see, they were all painting each other all the time, the Bloomsbury set. They couldn't leave each other alone. So this is Duncan Grant, a very beautiful boy, painted by Dora Carrington, who no doubt was in love with him, but he would have been in love with some other guy, you know. That was the Bloomsbury recipe for life, you see. But she made a very nice painting of Duncan Grant, and he was a very close friend of Whaley's. And he was also, he liked to do photographs of rather beautiful young men. And this was George Mallory, the mountaineer, and a photograph by Duncan Grant. Luckily it's decent, otherwise I couldn't have shown it to you. Now, this is David Hawkes. It's got nothing to do with Arthur Whaley as such. It's a photograph I took a few weeks before he died in 2009. The reason I'm putting it here is because this photograph was taken in the country home frequented by the Bloomsbury set. And we had just walked around the whole house with the furniture painted by Duncan Grant and with this strange sort of drama whereby nobody knew which bedroom they were going to wake up in or who they were sleeping with. And after we came out of the house, I got this photograph of David gazing at the flowers with a wonderful smile on his face. I mean, he died 3 weeks later, but all his life, you see, David Hawkes, he held the Bloomsbury people in veneration because he thought they were the proof that English people didn't have to be boring and conventional. And, you know, they could break the rules. They could do things their own way. Of course, the ridiculous thing is you've only got to go over the channel to France, and everybody's doing it. I mean, you don't have to be a Bloomsburyite in France because that's just the French way, you know. But in England, of course, England's always been a very uptight place. And the Bloomsburyites were famous for just not caring about the rules, you know. And David always held them in great regard. So I wanted to put that in. And late in his life, when he was already getting quite sick, Arthur Whaley moved up to North London, out of the Bloomsbury area, and he bought a house in Highgate. And this is the house, in fact, in which he died in 1966. And that blue plaque is, in fact, this, you see. Arthur Whaley, poet, translator, and orientalist, lived and died here. Nowadays, you're not supposed to call yourself an orientalist, but I mean, you know, I'm very happy to be called an orientalist. And that's his deathbed photograph, taken by Alison in his house in Highgate, with the window open. Right, well, I'm going to just look at three poems translated by Whaley before tackling this rather difficult topic. If you turn to your handout, I've given you more than three, but I'm just going to look at three, starting on page five. I've called it A Little Whaley Anthology. Now, it's a strange thing, but a lot of people have written about how, you know, certain works of literature become sort of part of the canon, and they become very, very widely respected and very often anthologized. Now, this first poem is very—it's not very well known in Chinese, actually. It's by a gentleman in the later Han dynasty, the Ho Han period, called Zhang Heng, who is more famous as an astronomer. But he wrote a number of poems in the style known as Fu. And you know, the Fu, it's funny, people don't really read the Fu very much, but Arthur Whaley discovered them very early on in his career. He published a book in 1923 called The Temple. And in that book, he translated some eight or nine Fu, and he did them extraordinarily well. And this is, I think, the best of them all. And he himself once wrote that he thought this was, to his mind, the finest of all long Chinese poems. Now, I have yet to meet a Chinese person, a literary person, who knows this poem. It's not very often anthologized. And, you know, in Chinese, it's just called the Fu of the Skeleton. But he called it the Bones of Zhuangzi. And I'm going to read it because it's really one piece. I tried to cut it down, but it's impossible. And it's one of the most powerful translations ever made of Chinese literature in any form, prose, fiction, poetry, anything. And it's really a meditation on death. And of course, if we go back to the great poets of the 17th century, like John Donne, it's a kind of metaphysical poem. And it's time that the Fu was really reevaluated, because you know it became very unpopular in the 20th century, because it so often uses rather difficult words and so on and so forth. But in this case, it doesn't use difficult words really. It's just a very powerful meditation on a Taoist meditation on death. So if you'll bear with me, I'll read the whole thing in English, because it's one of the most wonderful translations. I find that it has echoes of Shakespeare. It's very Shakespearean. And the interesting thing is that after this, Whaley completely gave up translating Fu. He never wanted to do it again. And after I've read it, I'll try and explain why. So it's by Zhang Heng, and it begins like this. I, Zhang Pingzi, have traversed the nine wilds and seen their wonders. In the eight continents, beheld the ways of man, the sun's procession, the orbit of the stars, the surging of the dragon, the soaring of the phoenix in his flight. In the red desert to the south, I sweltered, and northward waded through the wintry bergs of Yeo. Through the valley of the darkness to the west I wandered, and eastward traveled to the sun's abode, the stooping mulberry tree. So the seasons sped, weak autumn languished. A small wind woke the cold, and now, with rearing of rein horse, plunging of the tracer, round I fetched my high-roofed chariot to westward. Along the dikes we loitered, past many meadows, and far away among the dunes and hills. So far it's a typical sort of traveling Fu, you know, which goes right back to the poems in the Chu Zi. It's about someone who's traveling through the universe, you see. But then it takes a very important turn. Suddenly I looked, and by the roadside I saw a man's bones lying in the squelchy earth, black rime frost over him. And I, in sorrow, spoke and asked him, saying, "Dead man, how was it? Fled you with your friend from famine, and for the last grains gambled and lost? Was this earth your tomb? Or did floods carry you from afar? Were you mighty? Were you wise? Were you foolish and poor? A warrior or a girl?" It's very, very Shakespearean. It's almost like something out of Hamlet, you know. Then a wonder came, for out of the silence a voice, thin echo only, in no substance was the spirit seen, mysteriously answered, saying, I was a man of Sung, of the kingdom of Zhuang. Zhou was my name. Zhuang Zhou, you see, Zhuangzi. Beyond the climes of common thought, my reason soared. Yet could I not save myself, for at the last, when the long charter of my years was told, I too, for all my magic, by age was brought to the black hill of death. Wherefore, O master, do you question me? Then I answered, let me pray for you to the gods of heaven and the gods of earth, that your white bones may arise and your limbs be joined anew. The god of the north shall give me back your ears. I will scour the southland for your eyes. From the sunrise I will rest your feet. The rest shall yield your heart. I will set each several organ in its throne. Each subtle sense will I restore. Would you not have it so? And now we come to the climax of the poem. The dead man answered me, O friend, how strange and unacceptable your words. In death I rest and am at peace. In life I toiled and strove. Is the hardness of the winter stream better than the melting of spring? All pride that the body knew, was it not lighter than dust? What Chao and Xu despised, what Bo Chang fled, shall I desire, whom death already has hidden in the eternal way? Where Li Zhu cannot see me, nor Ziya hear me, where neither Yao nor Shun can reward me, nor the tyrants Jie and Xin condemn me. Leopard nor tiger harm me, lance prick me, nor sword wound me. Of the primal spirit is my substance. I am a wave in the river of darkness and light. The maker of all things is my father and mother. Heaven is my bed and earth my cushion. The thunder and lightning are my drum and fan. The sun and moon, my candle and my torch. The Milky Way, my mote. The stars, my jewels. With nature my substance is joined. I have no passion, no desire. Wash me and I shall be no whiter. Foul me and I shall yet be clean. I come not, yet am here. Hasten not, yet am swift. The voice stopped. There was silence. A ghostly light faded and expired. I gazed upon the dead, stared in sorrow and compassion. Then I called upon my servant that was with me to tie his silken scarf about those bones and wrap them in a cloak of somber dust, while I, as offering to the soul of this dead man, poured my hot tears upon the margin of the road. It's one of my absolute favorite translations out of any language into English. And as I said, it has a Shakespearean ring about it. And I think that Whaley was actually quite shocked at how naturally he wrote this kind of really quite old-fashioned poetry, you know. It's mostly in iambics, ta-tum, 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 and it's mostly very, very rhetorical, very eloquent, and very powerful, you know, treating of a very huge theme, the nature of death, and then the way in which the Taoist transcends death. And it's a very, very great poem in English. I would be bold enough to say I think it's a better poem in English than it is in Chinese, you know, which is, I'm sorry, I shouldn't say that because that's a terrible thing to say, especially to a Chinese audience, but it's a wonderful English poem. And you know, when W.B. Yeats, maybe in my opinion the greatest poet of the first half of the 20th century, when he compiled the Oxford Book of English, of modern English verse in the 1920s, Yeats, he chose, as part of his anthology of modern English poetry, he chose two long poems by Arthur Whaley as examples of English verse. That's how highly Yeats regarded Arthur Whaley. But anyway, Arthur Whaley gave up translating Fu completely after 1923, and he just translated basically Shi poetry. He never translated Fu again. And I think he almost felt it was too easy. He wanted to be part of the modern movement, you know. And this poetry sounds too much like Swinburne or one of the late Victorians, but it's wonderful. I think it's absolutely superb. And all of those full translations in the temple need to be anthologized and read again. Now, the second one I want to look at with you is another rare example where Whaley translated a Ci poem. Now, he hardly ever translated Ci poetry, and I don't blame him, because Ci poetry is notoriously difficult to translate. I've struggled with it myself on several occasions, because, you know, Ci poetry is the most bizarre kind of poetry, because it's written to musical meters, and yet we don't know what the tunes are, so the tunes are forgotten. It's like there's a melody there, but nobody knows what it is. That in itself gives the Ci poem a magic, which is quite extraordinary, because it's an unheard melody. It's a melody which once existed but no longer does. And when you write a Ci poem, you always put the name of the tune, you know, even though you don't know what the tune is. And of course, the tune represents a meter, 3, 5, 7, 2, whatever. And in this case, this is a very, very famous poem by Li Hozhu, the last emperor of Nantang. And Whaley only translated one stanza, and he translated it as an example in an appendix of the different meters of Ci poetry. But it's a very interesting example of Whaley trying to do a Ci poem. And I'm sure you know the Chinese of this poem, and Whaley gets off to a pretty safe start. He says, you know, immeasurable pain. But even that, I mean, what an amazing way to translate Dorshachen. You know, I've looked at about 10 other translations. They're all dreadful. But immeasurable pain, it's almost operatic. You can almost imagine there being a lost melody that you can't quite hear, because it's musical. Immeasurable pain. It's a cry, you know. Immeasurable pain. My dreaming soul last night was king again. I'm going to read the whole thing first. As in past days, I wandered through the palace of delight, and in my dream, down grassy garden ways, glided my chariot, smoother than a summer stream. There was moonlight. The trees were blossoming, and a faint wind softened the air of night, for it was spring. It's the most lovely, charming English poem. It belongs to the kind of school that I would call the Georgian school. They were actually very anti-modernist. It's a very old-fashioned poem, again, in English. And I think Whaley was almost ashamed of it, because he never went back to translate a single Ci poem afterwards. And you see, he turned it into a lovely poem, but he also took enormous liberties with the Chinese. Half of the English simply isn't there in the Chinese. And yet it's a wonderful poem, so we have to forgive him. But I'll just tell you how he went wrong, because even Whaley, you know, goes wrong sometimes. He starts off by saying, my dreaming soul last night was king again, whereas it doesn't say was king again in the Chinese. But I mean, the point is, he wanted his reader to understand that the basic existential plight of Li Hozhu was that he was once a king, and he isn't anymore because he'd been taken off into captivity. So he added that. It's what you might call an incorporated footnote. And then it says, as in past days, I wandered through the palace of delight. That's okay. So I've got to change my glasses. I can't actually read. I realize now I've got the wrong glasses on. I wandered through the palace of delight, and in my dream, down grassy garden ways. Well, you see, there's no mention of grass in the Chinese. And actually, as you know, Chinese gardens don't tend to have much grass. It's a very Western idea. Every Western garden has to have a lawn, you know, and you play croquet, or you sort of play cricket, perhaps, or whatever. But grass is simply not part of a traditional Chinese landscape garden. Rocks, of course, and often pebbles and ornamental windows and artificial mountains and so on, and water. But a lawn, as he implies, this kind of lawn is simply not there in the Chinese. And he says, in my dream, down grassy garden ways, glided my chariot, smoother than a summer stream. Well, that's his translation of ch, or they usually pronounce it ju in this kind of thing, but ch wu liu shui, ma wu long. It has nothing to do with gliding down a summer stream. It actually says that what it means is that there was, outside my palace, there were just hundreds of cars, you know, waiting for their owners to come out of the court audience. You know, there were lots and lots of Bentleys parked outside my court, you know, waiting for me to let these people go. That, you know, that's how many cars there were, and the horses, there were equal numbers of horses. So it's got nothing to do with my chariot gliding smoother than a summer stream. And why, anyway, why summer? Because in the last line it says it's spring. So, you know, I have to say he's being a bit naughty here. He's confusing the seasons as well. And then the last Chinese, the last line of the Chinese just said, he says, Hua Ye Zheng Chun Feng. And he turns that into three lines. He expands it enormously and says, but it's very effective. There was moonlight. The trees were blossoming. And a faint wind softened the air of night, for it was spring. Again, it's a style of translation that he completely turned away from, because it's just, it's so old-fashioned, it's so wordy. He expands the whole time. He gets carried away with himself by the sound of his own voice. And he had a very nice voice, and he knew he could do it very easily. And so I think he turned his back on this early stuff. This was also in the book called The Temple in 1923. And really, what he did then was to work out his own system of translating Chinese poetry. And you know, I sort of wish he hadn't done that, because once he worked out his system, that's what he did for the rest of his life. And he translated, you know, Tao Yuanming, Bai Zhuyi, and Yuan Mei. They were his three favorite poets. He translated them according to his system. And his system was this. He knew, because as he got better and better, he understood Chinese poetry more and more. And he knew that Chinese poetry has regular lines, you know, five words to a line, seven words to a line, sometimes four or six. But basically, unless it's ci poetry, it has regular lines, and it's very important. It's, you know, he understood the nature of writing regular verse in Chinese was almost like a crossword puzzle. You had to have, you know, seven words, and the tones had to be this, that, and the other. The rhymes had to be this. You had to have parallel in the two middle couplets of a luche. He knew all of that. But he thought, how can I possibly capture that in English translation? So he decided, because of course English can't do that. We don't have tones for a start. And our language is not ideographic. It's a phonetic language. So he worked out his system, which was that he would have one emphasis, one emphatic syllable for each word in the Chinese. So I've given you this next example because it's an absolutely typical one. This is one of Bai Zhuyi's more famous sort of socially conscious poems about a charcoal seller. And if you keep one eye on the Chinese, you'll see that Weili has an absolute method. Every Chinese word has got an emphasis. And I'm going to read it in a rather artificial way to bring out those emphases, you see. The first line, you see, only has three words in Chinese. And Weili just says, an old charcoal seller. See, three syllables, three emphasis. Not syllables, but emphasis. Cutting wood and burning charcoal in the forests of the southern mountain. Seven stresses, right? Seven stresses. His face, stained with dust and ashes, has turned to the color of smoke. Seven stresses, is it? And he's got away from the iambic. It's not ta-tum, 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 ta-tum. It's kind of more conversational. He's trying to be modern, you know, because that's what he... Look at all his friends, you know. None of them are writing old-fashioned poetry. T.S. Eliot, Ezra Pound, no. They wanted to create a revolution in English poetry. And even Yeats, you see, in his later years. And Weili was part of that. He was very much a part of the living stream of English modernist English poetry. And when he devised this method, his poems started to take on a very recognizable quality. You could tell immediately a Weili poem, you know, another Weili poem, you see? The hair on his temples is streaked with gray. His ten fingers are black. the money he gets by selling charcoal, how far does it go? You see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's just enough to clothe his limbs and put food in his mouth. Again, it's not iambic, it's not tutum-tutum. It's got a very conversational sort of rhythm, but it's got a structure. He's devised a kind of rule. And, you know, I can understand that he needed to do that, but I'm a little bit sad because I have to admit that there's a certain uniformity about his later translations that is almost inevitable once he adopted this method. So Yuanmei tends to sound a little bit like Bai Zhiyi, and Bai Zhiyi sounds a little bit like Tao Yuanming, whereas, as you know, in Chinese they sound quite different. But then that's a dilemma, because how on earth do you achieve that? I'm going to keep the last quarter of an hour for this controversial topic because it's so important. So let me leave that little anthology with you and urge you, whoever you are, whether you're a first-year student or a very senior academic, to read as much Weili as you possibly can, because he never writes a bad sentence, you know. He's a master of English prose style, master of English style, full stop, and a very, very careful reader of Chinese. I mean, a very, very, he's not a kind of lazy reader at all. He's very, very focused and very, he's a real craftsman, you know. I think there's a wonderful passage. Let me see if I can find it quickly for you in my handout. It's by one of his many friends, a man called Peter Quinnell, who is a historian. I think it's probably on page 2 or 3. Yes, on page 2, halfway down, I think there are some very good quotations here, which I'll use to summarize Weili. Quinnell wrote, Weili was above all else, it's halfway down the page, about on page 2, Weili was above all else a remarkably exacting craftsman. He was first and foremost a creative artist who, amid the laborious data of scholarship, unearthed the raw material that his talent needed. I mean, that was the extraordinary quality of Weili. He was a very, very amazing scholar. A lot of people don't realize that. He was a real scholar. He could read about 10 languages, and he read Japanese and Chinese fluently, but he also read Latin and Greek and French and German and Italian and so on and so forth. And he read very, very carefully. He had eternal patience. And he wrote, he was a terrifically precision craftsman. He wrote with great precision. And he also knew how to concentrate. I love the quotation at the top of the page, because during the Blitz, you know, when the Germans were bombing London, Weili worked in the Ministry of Information, and he used to stay up late at night translating COG, you know, during the blackout. He even kept his light on because he was so crazy and he just wanted to translate COG, monkey, he called it. And, you know, if you look at that paragraph, it's about six lines down from the top of page 2. He continued writing in London during the Blitz, during the bombing, you see, translating COG. One must not be distracted from good work, he once remarked, by forces one cannot influence. So that was his way of coping with the dark days of the war. And while he was at work, everything else, all else, was eliminated. This is something he shared with James Legge. He was very, very single-minded. He knew how to concentrate. And once, when a solicitous charwoman, that means a thoughtful cleaning lady, asked whether her Hoover, you know, her vacuum cleaner, was disturbing him, because he was going around the office, he was zzzz, and Arthur Weili was sitting at his table translating COG, and she said, excuse me, Mr. Weili, am I disturbing you? And he said, I cannot be disturbed while I'm working, meaning that nothing would disturb him because he was concentrating so much on his work. He could work listening to Mahler's Ninth Symphony and he wouldn't be disturbed at all, you know. That was the kind of person he was. And he was a very dedicated and very precise artist with words. And as Peter Quinnell said, he found the raw material for his art in Chinese literature. and for that we must be eternally grateful. Also Japanese literature, of course. He translated both. And he was a true master, a real master. And it was my great regret that I took up Chinese literally a few days after he died. Now, I want to end on a somewhat controversial note. As I've said, I am the literary executor of David Hawkes. So that means I inherited all of his papers, all of his books, all of his emails, all of everything that he wrote, he gave to me. He just gave it to me in his will. I hold it on trust. And some 4 years ago, I made the decision in consultation with my mother-in-law, who is still alive, Mrs. Hawkes, I made the decision to donate the whole lot to Chinese University Library. Even though many of the items in the collection are extremely valuable, I mean, worth many hundreds of thousands of dollars, but Mrs. Hawkes and I felt that what Professor Hawkes would have wanted would be to donate it, because he wasn't interested in money. He never was. He always referred to American academics as merchant professors, you know, because he thought that all they wanted was money, you know. And he was always a very modest person, lived in a very simple lifestyle. So we thought it would be true to his memory to donate everything to the library. And I must say they've done a very wonderful job of cataloging it, and some of it's been digitized, and they've read every letter and they've summarized the content, some of it quite shocking, but I mean, there it all is. And scholars are constantly coming from China to read this documentation of a great translator's life. So I feel we did the right thing. Even though it was quite tempting, you know, to make a lot of money out of it, but we didn't give in to that temptation. I'm not trying to pretend to be frightfully virtuous. It just seemed to be the right thing, you know, because he was a very, very dear friend of mine, and I wouldn't want to do something that would be against his wishes. You know, his wishes. Now, when we come to the story of Arthur Whaley, I'm afraid it's very different. And I happen to know, because I have the file which David left, which simply says Whaley. It's a file with the name Whaley on it, and it contains his correspondence with Arthur Whaley's widow. We've seen her picture. Oh, what am I doing? How do I get this to go back? Oh, thank you. You're always ready to solve my problems. Lawrence, you're wonderful. What am I done? Is that going back? Yes, okay. Thank you. Yes, this is Alison Grant Robinson Whaley, who married Whaley in the last few years of his life. And at first, she was quite friendly with David because she knew he was Arthur Whaley's best friend. And I remember David Hawkes telling me the story of Alison telephoning him when Whaley was basically dying. And I've put in the words here on page 3, just above the heading which says some of Whaley's writings. There's two lines which I've called The Dark Road. And this is a story that David Hawkes told me. One day, Alison called him up in Oxford and said, David, I can't understand what Arthur's saying. He's lying in bed, I think he's dying, and he keeps muttering two words. I think they must be Chinese. Can you tell me what he's saying? So David said, well, can you repeat them to me? And she said, well, it sounds something like yo tu, yo tu. I don't know what he's trying to say. And David, of course, knowing Whaley very well, said, oh, well, this is a Buddhist expression for the road through the darkness, the road, and it's the yo meaning dark, or, you know, and tu means a road, you see. And it's a term in Chinese Buddhism. And Arthur Whaley was, you know, like so many translators, he lived in two worlds. And one of the worlds that he lived in was a Chinese world. And in his mind, as he was drifting towards death, he was traveling through the dark regions of the Buddhist underworld, you know. And he, in his imagination, perhaps, or maybe his spirit really was. And so, at that stage, there was still communication between Alison and David Hawkes. And then he died. And his will was read out, and he had named David as his literary executor and left everything to him, all his written work and everything. And he also gave him his car, actually, interestingly enough. So David then set about doing what every literary executor does, which is to try and find out what there is and to decide what to do with it. And he knew, because he used to see Whaley regularly, he knew that Whaley was working on several projects that he hadn't finished right up until his death, and that he had lots of unpublished translations and a huge amount of correspondence with very important people. So he said to Alison, I really would like to, you know, have a look at his papers, if you don't mind, because I need to catalogue them and think about what we should do, because he left them to me. I'm his literary executor. Now, Alison's reply to that, and I have it in her own handwriting in my file, was to say, it's all disappeared. There's nothing. And David said, what do you mean it's all disappeared? It was there. No, no, it was all stolen by the rubbish man. Oh, no, I'm sorry, I lost it. No, 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 it went up in flames. She kept changing her story. And it was a big scandal at the time. There was a whole correspondence in the Times Literary Supplement. And people were really getting very angry because they knew there was stuff, but she refused to admit that there was anything there. And at the time, people thought her reason was that she wanted to destroy all trace of Beryl, because Beryl was her great competitor. She didn't want any mention of Beryl, because she had to make this claim that Arthur Whaley loved her all his life and he never really loved Beryl. You know, I mean, it's a human thing, but not a very nice human thing. And she wrote a book called Half of Two Lives, in which she tried to turn her relationship with Arthur Whaley into a great lifelong romance. It got some terrible reviews. One of them I thought was quite funny. It said, in this extraordinarily insane book, Alison Whaley is discovering her inner teenager. Which I thought was a wonderful summary of it's got some fantastic scenes. Like one evening, Arthur and I were sitting in the kitchen and we'd been drying our socks above the fire and the socks were still dripping. So I took one of the socks down and I wiped Arthur's face with it. And I kissed him and, you know, and we fell into each other's arms. Well, I mean, Arthur Whaley didn't behave like that, you know. I'm sorry. I mean, I never met him, but I know he didn't. And she was just living out her teenage fantasies, you know, when he was already paralyzed in bed and he couldn't do anything about it anyway. And then a month before he died, she dragged him off to the registry office and married him, which gave her certain legal rights. So David couldn't get anything out of her, nothing. He tried for about a year, and finally he just gave up, because it was so frustrating. She wouldn't hand over anything, and she kept saying it had all gone. Disappeared, stolen, burnt, something or other. And in the end, he consulted his lawyer, and the lawyer said, you better just sell back your rights to Alison, because this is going to haunt you for the rest of your life. But you better do it properly. So he sold his rights back to Alison for £1. £1. He had to have some kind of proper transaction, otherwise it wouldn't be legal. And from that day onwards, he never wanted to have anything to do with Alison ever again. And he used to say, don't ever mention her name in my house. Don't darken my days with the name of that witch. Those were his very words. He thought she was actually a very bad person. That was some years before he died. And then he died in July the 31st, 2009. Now, this is where it starts to get interesting. I'm sorry, but it does. Not long after he died, a huge mass of his papers appeared on the antiquarian book market in New York. I mean, somebody, I know who it was trying to sell them for a very large sum of money. I've had the figure of $1 million mentioned. I don't know if it was that much. But the antiquarian book dealer just said, no, that's too much. So the thing went up for auction. All these papers went up for auction. And if you now turn to your handout, this is the first time I've spoken about this in public, I have to say. I thought about it very carefully. And I feel, as David's literary executor, it's my duty to do this on his behalf, because he was so upset about it, because these are the papers of a very great man. Anyway, they appeared at auction at Christie's in November 2011. And if you look at the last pages of your handout. All I've done is to copy down the descriptions given by Christie's at the auction. It's all on the internet. I mean, I haven't made anything up. It was all there. And if you look at these papers, your heart just bleeds, you know, because I've tried to tell the story of Arthur Waley's life based on virtually no evidence. I mean, I've just had lists of people he gave books to, photographs, things like that. What I needed more than anything else were the documents, the letters, you know, hundreds of letters. And if you look at these auction details, there they all are, you see. And they were all sold at auction in November 2011 for a huge sum of money. If you look on page 11, you'll see the first lot. Arthur Waley, a series of approximately 127 autographed letters signed and 32 autographed postcards signed to Beryl Dazoot. The majority sent from London, Gordon Square, that, you know, Bedford Hotel and so on. Also from Zagreb and so on and so forth. That was the first lot, and those sold for £8,215, which of course is not that much, but that's the beginning. The second lot, at the bottom of page 11, a series of 23 autographed letters and two typed letters signed to Oswald Sickert, that's the brother of the famous painter Walter Sickert, he was a great friend of Waley's, and they do have some illustrations of some of these items on the Christie's website, and you can actually look at them on the internet. I'll just show them to you because it's so frustrating because really the here we have, for example, three letters from the Christie's auction signed by W.B. Yeats. Letters to Waley from W.B. Yeats. Now, I just knew they were friends, but I haven't been able to read these letters. I mean, I can't read them. They're not very well reproduced on the internet. But this is to give you some idea of the incredible wealth of material that was sold at this auction. These are all letters from Carrington, Dora Carrington, the painter, you know, the painter who was in love with Lytton Strachey, probably in love with Arthur Waley as well, you know. And here are all of her letters. And this one was from, oh gosh, I can't see who that is. Anyway, look, these are the, wait a minute, did I write it on the caption? Oh yes, this is from Virginia Woolf, right. Dear Mr. Waley. And these are his letters. These are the ones I just mentioned to Oswald Sickert. And this is a manuscript that is actually in the Southampton University Library. They have four manuscripts of early drafts of Waley's translations. This is a famous poem by Tao Qian, you see. I mean, this kind of stuff is absolutely precious, you know, for students of translation, for people wanting to understand Waley. This is the kind of stuff we need, the primary material that we need to have, you know, to understand what's going on. This is, look at Alison. I mean, she's absolutely shameless, you know. She puts this picture of herself on the cover of her book, and she has a picture of Waley with his chest, you know. I mean, she really is writing a kind of Mills and Boone romance, you know. And you know, it's a complete fabrication, but I'm glad she's discovered her inner teenager at last. But let's finish the story because it gets worse. So if you turn the page to page 12, you get to item number three, which is just says the remaining correspondence of Arthur Waley between 1917 and 1966, including correspondence. You included T.S. Eliot, Sir Frederick Ashton, Ben Berenson, Kenneth Clarke. You know, the list goes on and on and on. Michael Tippett, the composer, Stephen Stender, the poet, Sir Stanley Unwin, his publisher, Rebecca West, you know, H.G. Wells' mother, and so on and so forth. Approximately 440 letters and cards went for £8,125. Okay, so far it's not a huge amount of money. Wait till you get to the next lot, number four, sinologists. Of course, my ears prick up. Important collection of letters to Arthur Waley from sinologists and other Oriental scholars, as well as writers concerned in translations and interpretations of Chinese and Japanese literature, including Etienne Balash, Charles Board, Clifford Batts, Mary Boyce, Edward Conzer,
Ananda Kumaraswamy, Paul Damien Deal, William Dobson, John Fortune, Herbert Charles, etc., etc., etc. David Hawkes, 34 letters from David Hawkes. And David was trying to get hold of his stuff, and Anson told him it had all been lost and stolen or burnt or something. And that included 34 letters that he wrote to Arthur Whaley, and so on and so forth. And then you look at the price, this particular lot reached was £157,250, and so on and so forth. And all of lot number five, Beryl's correspondence. And lot number six, and this is the other tragedy, lot number six, Arthur Whaley, his archive of literary manuscripts and research notes in approximately 26 notebooks, 7 ring binders, and unbound leaves in approximately 20 folders or packets, a great variety of material ranging from drafts to typescripts for books, broadcasts, essays, translations, some apparently unpublished, notes on Japanese propaganda, etc., 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 £34,850. And the whole lot came to £220,225. Now,
you know, I don't want to preach a sermon. I mean, I think Mr. Robinson, he's the person who sold them. He was Alison's son by a previous marriage. No relation of Arthur Whaley's at all, but he became the person in charge of the Whaley estate. I've had dealings with him over the years. He used to charge a huge amount for every line of Arthur Whaley. He was making a fortune out of his stepfather. And, okay, I can't say that it's a crime for him to get £220,000. £225. That is not what I'm arguing about. What I'm arguing about is the fact that this was sold to a private investor from China, whose name cannot be revealed by the auction house because they're not allowed to do that, which means that this is going to disappear completely. It'll be put in a bank vault. It's been bought as an investment, you see. In 10 years' time, it'll be worth probably £1 million because it's a very wise kind of investment nowadays, this kind of thing. Now, good for him, you know. He's going to make a fortune, so is John Robinson. What about us, you know? What about the people who care about Whaley as a translator? What about the cause of translation? What about the cause of literature, you know? All of this has been ignored. And whereas David Hawkes' papers are there in the library for people to read, for people to learn from, for people to be inspired by, you know, Arthur Whaley's papers are sitting in a bank vault and no one can even see them. All we have are these tantalizing descriptions from the Christie's auction notes. That's all we have. And even these notes tell us a huge amount, but it's not enough. You know, it is a crime, really. It's a crime, and I dare say nothing will happen about it, but it needs to be recognized, it needs to be spoken about, it needs to be known, because this is a truly exceptional and wonderful, unique translator who did so much to make Chinese literature popular and loved the world over, you know. And we need to know his story. I've more or less given you the story as far as I can tell you, but there's so much more to find out, and every detail will help us, you see, to understand this man and to learn from his example how we can, you know, go about our job as translators in a better way and not let his lessons be forgotten, you know. So I do feel very strongly about this, and I hope you'll forgive me for taking this opportunity to make this known, because I felt it would be a good moment when I have a few people here who I know share my views, and that we can put this on record as being a scandalous state of affairs. I don't want to end on that note, because that's a very depressing note. I think I must remove this picture of Alison from the screen. Excuse me. She's no longer alive. She died in 2001, I think, at a very old age. Yes, that's much better. Now, I think that I want to end with a simple sentence by another very great poet, British poet of the 20th century, who is called William Empson. Now, I want to mention Empson because when I come next week, I shall be talking about David Hawkes. And you see, as you realize by now, one of my themes is that to know somebody, you need to know their friends. And in the story of David's life, perhaps the most important, the most influential single person was William Empson, with whom he lived in Peking in 1948. And William Empson was a very different kind of person from Whaley. He was a very intellectual poet. I don't actually like his poetry very much, but he was a very, very clever man. He wrote one of the most important books of literary criticism in the 20th century, Seven Types of Ambiguity, which is a good book, I think. I mean, he was very into close reading, and he and his teacher and friend I.A. Richards spent many years in Peking. And anyway, Empson wrote, I thought, a very nice appraisal of Whaley, and I'll just find it.
It's at the top of page 2. And this is what
William Empson wrote. It's the fourth line of page 2. And he said, a large capacity to accept the assumptions of any worldview without assuming any merit for our own. This is the basic virtue of Whaley's mind. And you see, this puts him in the same lineage as James Legge, because if you remember, one of the things that was said about James Legge was that in his work on the Chinese classics, he was trying to reach out to what he called the universal Chinese mind. And you see, I think that's what great translators do. They encounter another culture, and they feel connected to it. They feel a kind of yuanfen, you know. They feel an affinity with it, and they then devote themselves wholeheartedly to trying to transmit the inner essence of that culture. And this is what Legge called the universal Chinese mind. He was not, he was very, very respectful of Chinese thought, was James Legge. And of course, Herbert Giles was very respectful of the Chinese art of storytelling as well, in his funny kind of way, as I exhibited last week. But Arthur Whaley really was the first to tackle poetry, you see. I mean, Giles's poetry translations were okay, but they just weren't on the same level. Whaley really entered into the mind, the poetic mind of China, as no one had done before. And then he miraculously found ways of recreating it in English, which really were groundbreaking. I mean, he just did things that no one could have imagined were possible before. I mean, his book on Bo Zhuyi, his book on Yuan Mei are fantastically interesting studies to read, and you get from them a sense of a real Chinese, but a real universal poet, a person with whom Arthur Whaley was totally in tune. And, you know, he only picked the ones he liked. That was his way, you know. But the ones he did like, he made the most fantastic job of communicating their whole world and recreating it in loving English. And that's why I always say to students, you can never do better than read Whaley side by side with the Chinese, because he always chose good material. And if you read Whaley, you'll also be learning good English, and you'll be seeing a master translator at work. Thank you very much. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Any questions from the floor? Any questions?
I'm very grateful to be here because of a couple of friends. My name's Michael. I've been a student of John Min for 30 years now. I could ask 5 questions, but that's impolite, and other people should ask questions. But I had a couple questions that came to mind. One of them was, I'm not a translator. I know some translators who are really great, and I wanted to keep working with them. But one of the things you said that really struck my mind was, and I haven't encountered Arthur Whaley, and I want to go do that. That's on my list of things to do this year, is to get to know Arthur Whaley better thanks to this lecture. Thank you very much for that. But there was something in you, you're recreating the magic of Bloomsbury. And just to oversimplify, a few people got it right. They made translation choices with a sensibility. And what was their magic choice? They were somehow connecting to universal values, or just making good style choices or literary choices, you can't ever get it perfectly right. Translation is not an exact science. You've got to make subjective choices. But some of those translations from 1910 speak to us as though they were written yesterday, and some of them are 100 years old. If you look at a tree, it doesn't look worse for being 100 years old. Some translations look really, wow, you could never assign that in a class. So what did they get right? What were the choices they made? Can you generalize at all about how we should approach translation, and in those difficult crossroads of making choices, is there any consistent strategy for getting it right so that your choice will still be readable, and maybe even the best choice possible 50 years on, 100 years on? Thanks, John, for coming.
I won't say thanks because that's such a hard question. So no thanks to you, Michael. I mean, you know, Ezra Pound was always talking about making it new, you know. And he was one of those. I mean, he lived in a different world from Whaley. Their paths crossed, but they belong to different worlds. I mean, Ezra Pound was, of course, absolutely amazing. He had a way with words. You see, I think that, of course, we need to know the period. We need to know their friends. We need to know the circle, their moment in history. But beyond that, you know, there just are people who are just incredibly gifted, you know. It's a pathetic answer, you know. I don't have a Skopos theory or this, that, and the other. I mean, these people were masters, you know, and they were, look at Whaley when he was 7 years old in that wonderful Lord Fauntleroy suit, you know. You could see he was destined to do great things right from the moment he was born. He was a genius, you know, but he also was an incredibly dedicated craftsman, and he labored and labored and labored. And one of the things that I've found over the years is that people often are reluctant to do that eternal patience thing, you know, and that's where you often notice them falling down, because they're in too much of a hurry, you know. And whereas Whaley was just someone who just worked on his own for hours and hours and hours, you know. And all the people I've been talking about, and we'll go on to talk about Hawks next week, they're all like that. But it's not just a matter of their habits and their dedication. They also had a stroke of genius, you know. I mean, I think Hawks is the only person I've ever known in my life about whom I would say without any question that he was a genius, you know. He had a quality of mind that set him apart, you know. He had his background, he had his social background, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. He had his teachers and so on. He studied Latin and Greek and so on. But he also had something very hard to describe, you know, a quality that is so rare. And, you know, he said that about Whaley. Well, I'll say it about him, you know. We don't find people like that very often in our lives. And he had a way of getting to the heart of things that I've never encountered with anyone else, a way of his mind burnt with such an intense flame, you know, that when he was translating, it was really quite scary, because you could sense that he was cutting his way through, you know. I mean, most of us just sort of drift around on the surface and occasionally plunge down and pick up something and say, wow, aren't I clever? But he was like, you know, he was like a Bunsen burner. He was just burning right the way through, you know. And you know, I think in their different ways, all these four people that I'm talking about, they all have that quality. And you could just ignore their background, ignore their education, but I think that all feeds in, you know, it's nature and nurture, all the same old thing. And I think that, but in answer to your question, I think that what really sets them apart from everyone else, people who might have had the same education, the same background, the same proclivities and so on, was actually this extraordinary inner power, you know, that they had. I mean, you know, they talk about the Tao and the Da. Well, they had this power that came from their inner nature, which they would have applied to whatever they did, you know, whether they were going to be, whatever they were going to be. And that would be my answer. It's not very useful, I'm afraid. Sorry. You know, so, yes.
Another student with a shorter, simple question. Yeah. Arthur Whaley was famous for never visiting China, and there are stories about why he didn't, but did he have any Chinese native speaker collaborators?
Did he have any Chinese collaborators? I think it's fair to say no. I mean, he hardly spoke Chinese at all, He didn't meet. He met Chinese people. For example, he met Su Jimo when Su Jimo came to England. But Su Jimo probably spoke to him in English. And he was he just didn't want to go to China, you know. Why should he bother? I mean, he lived in the China of the Tang Dynasty, you know. He lived in maybe the 18th century when he was working on Yuan Mei. And it never even occurred to him to go. Now, and Chinese people are often extremely critical of this, and they think that therefore he couldn't have been a good translator. I'm terribly sorry, they're wrong, you know. What he's dealing with got nothing to do with modern China, you know. It's got nothing to do with pollution and, you know, the political struggles that go on within the Politburo and et cetera, you know. I mean, even though Xi Jinping can go to London and say, you know, Ni Zhong Yo Wo, Wo Zhong Yo Ni, and, you know, talk about cultural exchange, it's a load of rubbish, you know. And that would have been of no interest to Arthur Whaley at all. He lived in the very rarefied world, the world of great literature, you know. And, I mean, David went to China, very different. He had a particular reason to go. But after he left China in 1951, he never went back once. He never wanted to go back. He couldn't bear the thought of going back. And he said to me, I travel around Peking in my dreams every night. I know every street in Peking. Why would I go back to see them after it's been destroyed? You know, I'm not interested. The number of times he was invited to go back, and he never once went. Not once. I won't talk about myself because I think it's irrelevant, but I mean, Whaley just simply, for him it was irrelevant, you know. It never even bothered him. It doesn't bother me, you know. He once said, and it's absolutely playing into my hands, someone said to him, how on earth did you teach yourself Chinese all on your own in the British Museum? How could you do that? And he said, oh, it's easy, you know. Once you've studied Latin and Greek, it's just so easy, you know. You know, which is of course what I've been trying to say all along. And not that I'm saying to people you should go and study Latin and Greek, no. But it's in his mind, you know. It's to do with your mind. And it really wasn't, he wasn't tempted at all. But I mean, that's not really answering your question, but I mean.
I'm more interested, did he have a native speaker?
Not that I know of at all, no. He had a Japanese friend that he spent a lot of time with who helped him with stuff, but that was different. I may be wrong, but I don't think he had a Chinese collaborator at all, no.
Any other questions?
Hi, Professor. My question is a rather simple one, and it's not really related to this talk, but I really want to know, among all those stories by Jing Rong, why did you choose to translate the DNA culture? That question interests me a lot. Thanks.
I've kind of made it a rule not to talk about Jin Yong. So, you know, it doesn't make me feel very happy, and it won't make you feel very happy either. However, I can answer your question. It's very simple. A couple of friends of mine basically advised me. I was first introduced to the work of Jin Yong by a lovely dear friend called Sung Chi, Stephen Sung, who said, you've got to understand Hong Kong, you've got to read Jin Yong, he said. They work together in the film industry and so on. And Jin Yong is an extraordinary phenomenon. And then I talked to other friends, including Joseph Lau, Liu Xiaoming, who was always giving me advice. And he said, John, you know, don't waste your time on those real Wu Xia Xiao Shuo. You want to read his anti-Wu Xia Xiao Shuo. You want to read the last one, Lu Dingji. And I mean, I didn't have time to read all of Jin Yong's novels and then choose for myself. So, and then another friend of mine, Jeremy Barmey, he said the same thing. John, you'll really like Lu Dingji. I don't know whether they think I'm like Wei Xiaobao or something. But anyway, I'm not at all. I mean, I'm neither a sadist nor a philanderer. So, but I mean, the point is, in my life, I often take the advice of friends, you know, because I don't have time to read the whole of Chinese literature. And sometimes I just take things on trust, you know. And in this case, it was friends who told me to read, to do Lu Dingji. So that's my answer. And anyway, I don't want to talk any more about Jin Yong.
Someone has. Maybe one last one. one last question.
I want to add one little footnote, which is to do with Arthur Whaley and the I Ching, because, of course, I've recently worked on the I Ching. Arthur Whaley wrote the most brilliant essay on the I Ching in 1933. It was published in Stockholm in Bernhard Carlgren's journal. And it's only about 15 pages long, but it's one of the most brilliant studies of the I Ching ever written. And in one of his footnotes to that article, he says, when I write my translation of the I Ching, I intend to do blah, 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 blah. And of course, he never did. And I've always, if I could meet Arthur Whaley today outside there, you know, in some yotu, you know, some dark passageway, I would say to him, just tell me, why did you not do the, because he ended up doing the Shi Jing, the Book of Songs, instead. But he never took on the I Ching. I would just like to know why, because he announced his intention of doing it in 1933, and he would have done the most extraordinary I Ching. I mean, far, far better than mine. He would have done a wonderful translation, but perhaps he just discovered he wasn't enjoying it. He liked to do things for pleasure, you know. That was the key, you know. 从心所欲, he did what he wanted to do. And that was the secret. That's part of the secret to his great success. He never worked on something he didn't like, you know. That was, you only got to look at those Bloomsbury people. They were just having a great time, you know. Life was for them a picnic, you know. A very special kind of rather promiscuous picnic, you know. And I think he must have decided, my guess is that he decided that the I Ching was too much like hard work, you know. And so he decided to do the Shi Jing instead. But I've always been curious. Sorry, I asked myself my own question and answered it. Thank you. Have we got time for one more? Was there any more? No?
If no, please join me to give a big round of applause to Professor Minson.